All right, so my first question for you all this morning is, what's a palindrome date? Anybody know what a palindrome date is? So 1/20/21 is a palindrome date because it reads the same forwards as it does backwards. So the bonus question then is, when's the next palindrome date? Come on, you guys, wake up. Tabitha, do you know?
I sure do not know.
Will, when's the next palindrome date after today?
February 20th of next year.
Nope, tomorrow's the next palindrome date. When's the next one after that? The next 10 days are palindrome dates.
Isn't tomorrow would be 1/21/2021? Or are you not counting the
1/21/21?
Okay.
And that goes through, yeah.
Well, February 22nd, 2022 for if you include the 20.
Yeah, you don't include the 20 in the abbreviated date. So 1/29/21 is a palindrome date. And all the ones in between. And that has absolutely no bearing on what we're going to talk about today. I just thought it was interesting. All right. So today we're going to talk about term sheets. But before we do, I wanted to do a couple of review steps on valuation. So our first three workshops are complete. We'll take some time at the end of today to go through anything you want to talk about, any questions you may have relative to all the stuff that we've covered. Today, I want to give you a couple of valuation tools. And then we'll go through the exhilarating topic of term sheets. So in the valuation workshop, what we talked about was a whole series, a group of methods for valuing a startup. And the basic idea is it's pretty hard to put a valuation on a startup when the only thing you're working with are prospective financial statements as opposed to real revenue and real earnings. Once a company's up and running and there's a revenue run rate and there's a business model that really proves itself by producing earnings, then valuation becomes more of a formula. It becomes more of a mathematical exercise than it is any kind of subjective, artistic view of where a company can go and what its return might be. Certainly doing industry benchmarks is one possibility. Discounted cash flow is another possibility. Has Anna joined us yet? No.
She has not.
Well, if she's able to join us today, I'd like to bring her into the conversation because she's just finished a valuation by an outside company. And what occurred to me in going through the review of that work with her is that context of valuing a company is also really important. So how you value a company it very strongly depends on whether you're an investor, whether you're a current owner and perhaps management team member, whether you're a bank, whether you are an incoming employee who's being offered options. And the reason why I bring that up is from my own experience, there is a once the valuation is done, there are different adjustments that are made to that bottom line number, one of which is an additional discount for being a non-voting type of stock. So in my company, there were only two different kinds of stock. There was no preferred, there was none of that. There was voting and non-voting. And voting was legally allowed to elect the board of directors. Non-voting had all the rights of voting shares, including what its ultimate liquidation value was on exit, but it was not, it did not have the right to vote for the board of directors. So a non-voting share was discounted. Well, a voting share was discounted by 10% to arrive at a non-voting share value. Same thing applies to marketability. So across all classes of stock, there can be a non-marketability discount. And in some cases, it can be big. It can be 35, 40, 45%. So it's not that you need to actually come to grips with the value of those discounts, the actual numerical formula that, you know, trying to, you know, put a number on what that really means to you, but know that those discounts exist and you'll need to work through them when you get to that point. So we talked about required return on investment. We talked about some of the empirical methods, which are really simplistic. But what I wanted to do was also show you two valuation models, Loon Creek. Now, Loon Creek is a source of information that comes to us through the Angel Capital Association. It is, it's authored by a fellow named Kevin Learned. I think he's got some YouTube stuff, really bright guy, and very much engaged in early stage investments. And then Seraph, which I'll show you in a second. So, oh boy. So let me see if I can get this zoomed in a little more. So I will always remember Will Fitzhugh's comment the first time I presented the Loon Creek valuation model, because this is a real simple model. And it is designed to do two things. And those two things are highlighted in the instructions. One thing it can do is it will provide the pre and post money valuations given the size of an expected exit. So if in this particular way, in that particular calculation, if you plug in the size of the round and the expected exit and the expected future dilution in the company post-investment, then let me see if I can't get this straightened out here. My handles are different. Then what it does is it runs through a calculation and says, well, the post money with dilution is $4 million less the round of the less the size of the round. Pre-money valuation is $3 million. So if you plug $1 million in, if you invest $1 million and you expect an exit at the $25 million level, And you expect that there will be 20% dilution between your investment and the exit, then the post-money valuation is $4 million. That's what this spreadsheet calculates for you. So the other approach is to plug the size of the round in, plug the size of the round in. So there's $1 million investment going in. The pre-money valuation is $4 million. You require a multiple of 7 times your money back. There's 0% dilution in this example. So what's the exit got to be? Well, the exit needs to be $35 million. So this particular workbook, with its two kind of functional worksheets in it, give you the opportunity of working the size of the round, pre and post money valuation, and exit value with some other smaller variables. You can play with those. You can play what if games with that. So we'll send you that particular spreadsheet. And then what I also wanted to give you is the Serif valuation model. And there's kind of a precursor that you need to understand before we jump into the Serif valuation model. And that is the basic concept of the way their workbook is structured. And what is counterintuitive to me anyway, is that the adjustments that are made have a sign convention that's reverse of what you might think. And I'll show you what that means. But their visual is that there are three groups of adjustments that can be considered in valuing a startup. One is, what are the current deal environment conditions? What are the financing requirements? And what's the exit reality? And those three groups of adjustments act on the valuation. And the bigger, the more important any of those can be, the harder they will force inward on the valuation. So the bigger those requirements become, the smaller the valuation. And where the convention gets a little confusing is if an adjustment in this left panel, if an adjustment is smaller, then the valuation gets higher. And if the adjustments are bigger, then the valuation gets smaller. Well, so what that means is that the sign convention, either positive or negative, gets a little reversed. So when the financing requirements or any of these adjustments get smaller, which in my mind means they would be negative, they're actually not in the model. They're positive because it has a positive effect on the valuation. So when I show you the workbook, you'll understand how this all kind of comes together. But that sign convention is a little bit backwards. So here's what the Serif valuation workbook looks like. And we're also going to send you this. And I'll tell you the real reason why I'm sending you this to begin with. So as you look at each of these criteria, and what its adjustment is. So there's a very big market, several billion target addressable market. that's green, but it has a negative sign associated with it. So greens are negative, reds are positive. That seems a little backward, but that's just the way this model works. But the real reason why I want to share this with you is that every one of these criteria, so this is the most detailed set of adjustments that I've seen that go to the valuation of a company. So here are the exit realities, here are the financing requirements, and here's the current deal and the current deal environment. And then those get added up and those get added up here in the top of the final sheet. And then the adjustments are made to the actual valuations and you plug your own valuations in here. But the real reason why I'm sharing this with you is because each one of those criteria is linked to a very detailed explanation. So in that particular criteria that I just clicked on, there's a write-up of what's behind that specific point. So
we're not seeing that. I'm just seeing a valuation model CXL workbook. I don't see, it looks like you may be pointing to things that I don't see.
I'm going to reshare that. Thank you for telling me that. So are you seeing that?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. Well, what I tried to do was click on one of these links over here on the notes column.
Yeah.
When we send you that, those links will be live. You'll be able to click on those and get a detailed article. Are you seeing that?
Yes.
So that particular criteria is described in detail under in this particular article that these guys have written. So they've got a whole series of articles, and those articles are organized according to this valuation model. And that's why I'm sharing this with you, because that I think is really valuable, is to have all of those articles organized in a way that cue into their valuation model. So if you want to know what an investor's thought is on meaningful revenue now or soon, you click on that article and it'll give you a full description on that. So we will send you those, we'll send you that spreadsheet, that workbook, and you can have all those links. And the guys from Seraph are also very involved in the Angel Capital Association and are more than happy to share their information. They actually run a service, so don't sign up for anything that's going to cost something, but their free stuff is really good. Okay, so with those two models, that wraps up our discussion of valuation. Any questions about those two models or anything else in valuation? Okay. Let's talk about term sheets. So what's a term sheet? When you actually get an investment, when you actually do a deal where an investor writes you a check and in return, he either gets a promise to repay. So that would be a debt kind of an instrument or even a convertible debt kind of investment, or she may get equity in your company. So that would be a priced round. And that deal, the real deal, ends up being documented in a deal book. And before the internet, before the time of, you know, shared files and documents and Google Drives and all that sort of stuff, These deals were actually done in real three-ring binder books. That book, that ultimate deal book, can be hundreds of pages long. That deal book also has a table of contents in it. And the table of contents is really what a term sheet is. It is a term sheet is a big picture, very abbreviated version of what the deal book will ultimately be. It's a summary of what the deal offering is. So it's a written formal proposal, and it simply outlines all of the parts of an investment. Typically, it's not binding, although I have seen recently binding term sheets. So a binding term sheet would be a contract between the company and the investor, and it is that binding contract would, of course, then be grounds for some legal action if either side chose not to proceed. It can originate, a term sheet can originate from either side of the deal, but it's typically prepared by a lead investor. So the lead investor is usually the party in a deal that comes up with the terms, who actually prepares a term sheet. And the term sheet would then be followed by, or negotiated and then followed by, the company and by other investors who may want to syndicate, who may want to join in the deal. When it's initially proposed, so if you are offered a term sheet from an investor, consider it to be highly negotiable. But also understand that all of your discussions up to that point are probably in the document. And so there really shouldn't be a lot of surprises. There may be some small points that need to get negotiated, but for the most part, it is a document that reflects on the discussions that you've had up to that point. I don't know where this format originated, and I don't want to go through this word for word. My point to you is, this is what a term sheet typically looks like.
Hey, John, I'm still seeing the Seraph model.
Really?
Yeah.
I'll be darned. It's a good model, but we really do want to show this other thing. How about that?
There we go.
So this is the format of, this is the format of a typical term sheet. So at Queen City Angels, if you were to ask Queen City Angels for a template, this is what they would show you. And, you know, it's got all of the obvious kinds of things in it, like who's going to be involved in the deal, what kind of entity the company is. So if it's an LLC or a C, it'll spell that out. If you are currently an LLC and the investor is going to require that you become a C, then it'll spell it out in the term sheet. Who the key names are of folks that are involved, when you expect to actually close. That would be when you're going to be able to cash your check. What type of investment? Are there tranches? So will the investment come in pieces? And if it comes in pieces, what will trigger those second and third tranches? Typically some kind of technical milestone. What the pre and post deal cap tables look like. What a board of directors may be and if the investor is going to require that he or she be on the board of directors, or will there be board of directors or board observers? What are the requirements on both sides for confidentiality, and what company obligations are there? Typically, company obligations go to things like the access to documents, which honestly takes a lot of time for an investor's group to come into the company and start to review all of your contracts and all of your all of the arrangements that you have with your employees and all of the arrangements that you have with your suppliers, including things like insurance. It will require how you manage your balance sheet, most notably whether or not you can bring on new debt. There is and may be some discussion about how a founder or how other key employees may vest, may be required to enter a new vesting schedule. It'll discuss options, and we've talked about those in the context of our cap table. And it'll also describe the expiration of the offer if it's not actually able, you're not actually able to negotiate it. So a typical term sheet has four sections: management, investor rights and protection, the economics of the deal, and what happens when there's a liquidation event, including an exit. So the management of the company is going to be key to the way an investor is going to understand how he or she will actually work on a day-to-day basis with the company. So the first thing that's discussed typically is the election of the board of directors. The CEO of the company, which is probably you, is typically a member of the board of directors. And that's true, I think, not only in most private companies, but also public companies. And I'd love to debate the idea that a CEO and a board of directors is potentially a conflict of interest, because the CEO report, the CEO of the company reports to the board of directors. So how a CEO can act on a board of directors and issue directives to him or herself is a pretty interesting idea, but that's perhaps for another day. A CEO is typically part of the board of directors. Co-founders may or may not be on the board of directors. Investors may or may not be part of the board of directors. Sometimes a seed investor will become a member of the board, and when a second round investor gets involved in a separate, probably larger deal, a lot of times the seed investor will go away from the board. But again, everything is negotiable, and that's one of those things that actually does get actively talked about. A lot of times there is an independent board member, and the that independent board member is identified typically in a term sheet as being someone who's nominated by and acceptable to fill in the blank. So it could be nominated by company management and acceptable to the lead investor, or it could be some other combination of that. And then typically, well, not typically, but commonly, there are board observers. So those people will actually sit in the board meeting. They will be provided the same information that board members are provided, whatever it is, monthly or quarterly. and typically are not involved in conversations in the board. Sometimes they're asked questions by board members, but most importantly, they don't vote. We talked about, one thing that also is worth thinking about is when you get to the point of forming a board and there are people who are not on your management team and therefore don't have any form of compensation or equity options from the company. So say an investor or an independent board member, those board members are typically compensated. And there are sources of information that you can rely on that will give you an idea of how much they get paid, either in the form of cash or in the form of equity. So if you bring in a board member or even a senior advisor for that matter, equity can range anywhere from 0.5% to a couple of percent, maybe even 3 or 4%. And cash compensation is in the tens of thousands of dollars, usually maybe $10,000 or $20,000 a year. But like so many other things, that too is entirely negotiable. A lot of times the investor will add a term that requires the company to carry a key person and director and officer insurance, so that in the key person case, if the proverbial beer truck takes out you as the founder or one of your key management personnel, the insurance policy will pay the company to find a replacement, to find and pay for a replacement. Directors and officers insurance covers lawsuits against directors and officers for typically some kind of liability that may come out of the company, whether it's an employment issue or a product liability or some other sort of problem that the company can run into. Investors will require insurance be carried to protect for those things. Borrowing money from the bank typically requires board approval, and in this case would require an investor's approval. And the same with officers who you either are hiring or terminating. So officers, of course, are identified and approved by a board of directors, and they have the authority to carry out official business for the company. Probably most notably, they can sign a contract. And by signing a contract, they are bringing liability in some form, and perhaps several forms, into the company. So it's important that those people and those processes get approved, and investors will require that. In the shareholder agreement that ultimately gets prepared, it may be in the articles of incorporation or your charter, it does make sense to minimize shareholder approval unless it's absolutely necessary. And that step really is not designed to carve anybody out of the ability to offer their opinions or their wishes, but to simply expedite matters, to make meetings more efficient, to make actions, easier to push through. Change in control, which typically means being acquired or having some sort of liquidation event. Change in control typically requires all shareholders to vote. So you can minimize shareholder approval, but change in control is typically held as a shareholder right. Okay, the next section in the term sheet after management typically is investor rights and protections, anti-dilution, think cap table, and an investor may require that his or her position is not diluted in future by future activities, including bringing on individual investors, bringing in more investment. So that would mean that if the investor's not diluted, then any dilution from future investment would come out of your cap table line. So be careful when you're looking at anti-dilution terms. I think we talked about a future down round. So you in a current round, you agree to a certain valuation, and for some reason or set of reasons, you have a future investment requirement, and the valuation in that future round is actually less than the valuation of this of the current. Investors may require that you adjust their stock price so that any down round effects are concentrated onto founder shares or other shares, option pool shares that that won't affect them. So over time is going to be paid for by you. So be careful when you're reviewing terms like that. Participation rights. We're going to talk about participation in a minute. So let's hold off. I'll hold off the details of that for right now. But in effect, it means if an investor has a preferred form of stock, that the investor also has rights to participate as a common stockholder in the future, particularly if there's a liquidation event. There is a form of maintenance of prorated share for investors through a right to buy stock. So if there is dilution and there's no anti-dilution term, there may be a term that simply says that the investor has the right to buy more stock to maintain his or her prorated share. There could be some discussion about the expiration of investor rights, not usually typical. There are pay-to-play warrants and options, which mean that in order for, if you include warrants in a current investment round, so a warrant is a contract for the investor to buy more stock at the then current stock price, that if there's a new round of investment, that the investor may be required to pay to convert those warrants into actual shares in order to keep the warrants. So if the investor chooses not to pay to play, then those warrants disappear. So it's a technique to keep people involved, to keep the cap table from getting confusing and impossible to deal with later. But mostly it's a technique that's used to continually engage the investors with the company and to raise money. So when equity is eventually sold, so let's say that you have a vice president of marketing that you bring in this year in 2021, and you offer that person 10% equity that vests over 4 years. In 2026, nothing else has changed investment-wise. Your cap table's the same. You do have an investor, though. That VP of marketing decides that they're going to take another job, and you've got a part of your shareholder agreement. This is one that I recommend, that you, that in certain cases, that person needs to be an employee in order to keep that stock. So if the person resigns and goes to work somewhere else, then those shares are automatically deemed to be put up for sale. Then an investor may have the right or the first right to purchase those shares. And next point, if those shares aren't all sold, then investors may also have the right to sell their shares. So they're, so think about it in a buy-sell kind of a context, that it's, that it's important to visualize, to plan for what happens if somebody wants to leave. Then who may have the right to purchase those shares, or who may have the right to put their shares up for sale, similar to the departing employee. Okay, that's pretty, all pretty dense and complicated stuff. Are there any questions? Anybody have any comments or points that they'd like to raise? Okay, deal economics. So the economics of the deal that are based first and foremost on how much money is being raised and what the value of the company is. So those obviously are first and foremost in your mind as you're talking to investors, or if you're looking at a term sheet. The discount on debt conversion. So if you're in a convertible note situation, there's really a couple of key points. Sorry for the dogs. There's a truck coming up the driveway. There's a couple of things that are critical to keep in mind when you're thinking about convertible debt. One is, what's the cap on valuation? And the second is, what's the discount that we have to offer the investor when the debt is converted into stock? So typically there is a 20% or 25% or 30% discount on the conversion of the debt into equity. So that's a pretty important part of the deal. So think that through pretty carefully. Liquidation preference. So in preference to means before all others. So preferred stock does get paid before common stock. Doesn't get paid before debt, but it gets paid before other shareholders. Sometimes, for example, if you enter an investment deal where the investor gets a 2x preference. That means that if that investor puts in $100,000 and when you exit, they get $200,000 back. They get their investment plus one more. So one more X. So that is a straight liquidation preference. Most of the time, there is a participating preferred stock. So once the preference is paid, and the preference can be any multiple, it can just be one, or it could be, I mean, I've seen them as high as four, maybe even five, depending on how much risk is in a deal. So once the preference is paid, then one of two things can happen. Either the stock is entirely retired. It goes away. It has no more rights. The preference is paid. That's it. That would be non-participating. Or a participating preferred stock gets to enjoy the benefits of both. So the preference is paid, and then the stock turns into common stock, and it participates as a common stock holding. So some cases there is only a preference. Some cases there's this term called non-participating, where the investor can either get the preference or can opt not to get the preference and take the common stock plus up. So assuming that it's a successful exit and there's a big pop in the stock, maybe that's what the investor would like. Or more commonly, participating preferred is the investor's entitled to both a preference and a participation. Last money into a company usually makes the rules. So by that, I mean the last round in the company, not the last money into a specific round. Within a specific round, the lead investor makes the rules. But once an early stage investment is made and the next investment, call it a Series A, comes along, the Series A investors typically will take out the rights of the early stage investors. And of course, early stage investors never like that. So there's always a discussion about that. Early stage investors call those, and because Series A investors are typically venture capital funds. What angel investors like to term that is a VC haircut, because it typically will cost angel investors rights, which ultimately mean money in the end. So sometimes warrants get lost, sometimes preferences get dialed down, but the point is that as additional rounds are made into the company, those usually will make rules that are senior to the other investors that are already in. Dividends. So sometimes investors will require dividends, and a dividend simply says that we, the company, promise to pay you a certain percentage of your investment every year, typically every year. Sometimes it can be quarterly, but usually it's every year. I've not seen a lot of that. Queen City Angels doesn't work on dividends, and primarily because we see that as taking cash from the company, and early stage companies rely so heavily on cash that it seems counterintuitive to us, but some investors require require dividends. A mandatory payout at a specified rate. Oh, and let me back up. Dividends typically are, they're compounded, but dividends usually don't take on any sort of real complicated formula. It's fairly simple math. Mandatory payout at a specified rate may or may not be cumulative. Same, that really applies to dividends, but there also is a term that I actually am seeing more of at the angel level. Angels didn't typically used to do this, but they are now. And I saw Queen City Angels do one for the first time, and it's called redemption. And what redemption means is that the investor has the right to require the company to pay back the amount invested and maybe even some plus up to that, whether it's the dividends that have accrued or maybe even a preference. But a redemption is a deal term that means doesn't make any difference what happens. At some point in the future, the investor has the right to redeem his or her investment, and you have to pay him back. In my opinion, that's making an equity investment start to look and smell an awful lot like debt. I'm not even sure how it would be accounted for on your balance sheet, probably still as equity with a redemption term, but beware, that could be really important. So I think when we talked about the cap tables, we showed how option pools can affect cap tables. So typically when an option pool is created, you consider what the undiluted versus the diluted cap tables may look like. In the term sheet, you may require, or an investor may require you to dilute the cap table with options before an investment is made. So who can tell me why investors do that? I think maybe we've talked about this once. Who knows why an investor would want you to push your options into your cap table before, in a pre-money kind of a cap table, as opposed to a post-money cap table? It's because the investor doesn't want to pay for that dilution, doesn't want to be diluted him or herself. That's why, because I think as we talked about at the very beginning, investors are greedy people, right? That they're in it for the money. So they want to make sure that if there's any dilution that they can actually quantify on a cap table, they will force the founding team to take the dilution before they put their money in. So again, something to be aware of. Okay, exit and liquidity. And while liquidity sounds like it's kind of fun, it means that all of a sudden assets become cash and you can transfer it to your checking account and go buy a new car. Sometimes liquidity events aren't fun. You know, bankruptcy can be a liquidity event. So when you see the word liquidity, make sure you understand the context that it's being used in. Exit, less so. Exit typically means that there's going to be an acquisition or a merger. But if founders want to become liquid, if founders want to sell some of their stock, and they may want to sell it back to the company, and depending on your shareholders agreement, in my shareholder agreement, the company always had the right of first refusal to buy departing employees' stock, that employee transfers may be partially or completely intercepted by investors. So what an investor could be saying is the company may not have the right of first refusal, but rather the investor will put him or herself in place of the company as having the right of first refusal. And the company then would come second. So bear in mind that how money and how stock ownership moves from one party to another will be really important to understand in a term sheet. If a shareholder vote is approved by a specific percentage of voters, all affected shareholders are dragged along. I think that's probably obvious, although there is a drag along term, and it's actually called a drag along term in term sheets that specify what percentage of shareholders are required to approve certain transactions. It's not dissimilar from all the stuff that we've been reading about in the news, in terms of how many votes in the House or how many votes in the Senate does it take to override a presidential veto or convict a president of impeachment. So same thing applies. Terms are sometimes included in deals to specify how many shareholders are required to approve certain actions. And once that shareholder amount, once that percentage is approved or has approved an action, then all affected shareholders are dragged along. Buy, sell. If you have, back to my VP of marketing who leaves 5 years from now, what value will apply to that departing employee's stock transaction, either back to the company or maybe back to an investor, if an investor has a right to intercept that transaction. What we did and what I really recommend everybody come up with is perhaps not a hard and fast number, but a valuation formula. So you can base a formula on many of the things that we've already talked about. So you can put in benchmarks, you can put in cash flow, a discounted cash flow formula. We had a service that, and they still do, provide valuation formula for engineering companies. So we went to an outside service and they gave us a formula that we could plug our numbers into. So it's like, what's the multiplier times cash flow? What's the multiplier times revenue? What's the multiplier times your contract backlog? What multiplier against the number of employees that you have? So we had a valuation formula that we bought, and we bought it every year. And we would plug our numbers in, and the board would look at our formula and may make adjustments. You know, if there was, for example, an extraordinary event that affected our cash flow. Let's say we had a big receivable to a company, and that client company went bankrupt, and our receivable was cut in half. That very much affected our cash, but it really shouldn't affect our valuation, because that was an extraordinary event, and the half of that receivable that wasn't paid, we would add back and then adjust our valuation moving forward. Redemption rights, we talked about. Zombie killers. There can be a term in a deal. I don't think it's really referred to as a zombie killer. I think I made that name up. But what it means is that if the company refuses or is unable to make progress, if they're not able to execute on their plan, if their patents didn't get issued the way they thought they would, if they are unable to retain key employees, and the company goes into this, a death by walking around kind of a stage where the company is just really doing nothing, an investor may have a term in there that they can define by lack of growth, lack of ability to earn, lack of inability to grow the management or the technical team. There could be a redemption that can fall within the rights of the investor. So they could call their investment, and the company would be really in a bad way trying to pay them back. So beware of terms like that. Preferred shareholders require redemption. We talked a little about redemption. Redemption price is usually a purchase price plus some specific ROI. Talked a little about that. And then once a company registers for initial public offering, so in the rare case where you've made it to the point where you can actually put the company onto one of the major stock exchanges, that may be a trigger for investors to exercise their rights. Sometimes, and in my experience, and I've been on the founding team of a company that ultimately did go on to the stock market, an IPO. It fell off the stock market about a year later, but it made it through an IPO. We, as the founding shareholders, were required to maintain our ownership for a period of time. And I think it was about 6 months, but they vary. That could be a term in a deal that you're offered. So what deal terms are priorities? What will definitely be in your term sheet and likely to be less negotiable than other terms? The investment type and the amount, valuation, preference and participation, option pool dilution, what happens if there's a down round? So these, I actually should have put numbers on these, because these are in a bit of a priority order. Whether or not the investor has pro rata rights, meaning he or she may not have to suffer dilution, but will have to pay for it at the then stock price. Board seat. I put access to information in a highlighted font there because it really is important. Having been an angel investor that's very active with the companies that we work that are in our portfolio, I have to tell you that one of the reasons why we fail, when we look at our failures, one of the more obvious recurring reasons for failure is we just didn't know. And most of the time, I like to think that the founders that we work with are honest, honorable people with high integrity. Most of the time, the founders themselves didn't know. So shame on us all. As a board member, we would hope that we would be able to get the founder, we would be able to teach the founder how to look around corners to know where the pitfalls were. But boy, it really hurts when you find out that the information was really available the whole time and it just wasn't being being reported back up the chain. The very first angel investment that I wrote off was for that reason. The founder wasn't really following the direction that we were providing him, and was hiding information, particularly as related to things, important things like his cash position. So today you might find, for example, that investors may require you to provide them with your login and password for your QuickBooks account. So they may want to look at your checking account balance whenever they want. That's becoming more and more of a part of the deals that we work in. The status of proposals. So when a company is making a proposal to a big client, how that goes into the client, how the client reacts to it. If the proposal is accepted, what are the contract terms? You know, maybe a client will say, sure, I'll give you this work, but our payment terms are going to be pretty slow. So we're not going to pay you for 180 days. Knowing that as a board member or as an investor is critical to ultimately how we're going to be able to work with the founder and try and make a success out of this company. So access to information, I think you will see as a more and more important part of the way investors are going to want to work with you. So we have a little bit of time to talk about whatever you want. That's pretty much what we have on term sheets. We'll send this deck to you. There's a lot of information that you can Google about term sheets, deal terms, that'll go into much more detail. But I think you've got now, you've got a pretty good set of terms that investors will want to talk with you about and will want to propose to you in their term sheets. So don't hesitate to ask them or ask me to kind of think through what those terms may mean to you. Anything else that we want to talk about?
John, I think this is great information, and I appreciate you doing all of this. Guys, I'd like to see you be a little bit more interactive in the future. He's put a lot of time in this, and it's pretty easy, as I've done, to turn your speaker off and turn your camera off. I hope you're listening and getting some value out of this. I know the models will be useful to you.
Well, I can tell you from actually both sides of a deal, being part of an investment team and also being part of a founder team, even recently, these are tedious and unfortunately can be very meaningful discussions. And it's not difficult to make a mistake. So if you're considering a term sheet, make sure you go back and refresh yourself on what these different terms can mean to you.
Hey, John, I have a question.
Sure.
So, I mean, on the topic of making mistakes, do you have maybe like a list of kind of like the top five mistakes that you see most frequently done?
Well, I think that's an interesting question, where and I am thinking about mostly the way Queen City Angels works, and the possibility that other investors may not work that way. And specifically what I mean are a mistake. You can make a mistake, for example, by on one hand, making a great pitch to an investor, which is really a sales exercise, which is really meaning that you get to use marketing and sales license. So as you make your pitch, you're not highlighting where the risks really are. And there may be real risks. A good investor is certainly going to ask you, you know, what keeps you up at night? What are you most concerned about? How are you working to de-risk your technology or to de-risk your business model? All of those things can be kind of forgotten in the vigor, the enthusiasm that you have in getting investment and closing the deal. So I think the biggest mistake is a general one, and that is underestimating what your risks are and not putting risks out in front of an investor so that you can work on them together. And then seeing that some of the specific parts of your deal can turn in to bite you. So a down round really hurts. What a down round means, and we've talked about this, but what a down round means is that you have somehow destroyed value or part of your value. That's an ugly thing to have to wrap your mind around. And I think it is also, it can be a point that you can get pretty depressed over. And what's the cause of that? What mistake did you make end up in a down round? Your valuation was too high in your seed round. And that, of course, is difficult to deal with. So I suppose there are mistakes made in understanding what the risks are in all the different parts of your company. You know the way the company works way better than an investor does. A good investor is going to ask you a lot of good questions. One of my favorite ones is, so what questions haven't I asked you? What is it that you know about your company that we haven't talked about yet? I think it's a mistake to not really come through in an open discussion. I think that by itself is a risk. So not being forthright with your investors in every aspect of the business, not being able to arrive at terms, valuation is a pretty good example. If you overstate your value, then what can that mean to the future, particularly when you go into following rounds? Those are probably the biggest mistakes. And from the founder side, the biggest mistake I ever saw was the CEO of was an environmental data management platform, online platform, just simply hid stuff from us. That's a huge mistake. I not only think that full disclosure is necessary, but I also think if there's bad news, that needs to come first. Get that out of the way. And don't look on that as something that an investor is going to beat you up over. Think about it as a challenge that you're going to have to address together. And that even goes into how you consider the investor kind of big picture, how you visualize working with that person. So I think those are probably some of the bigger kinds of mistakes that I've seen made. There are certainly mistakes on, involvement directly in the company, negotiating contracts, setting pricing models. Sometimes those are difficult and they're kind of areas to make mistakes. But that's a good question. I'll think more about that while we're continuing to talk here. Who else has an idea, question, problem?
Hey John, thanks. Lots of really great stuff. I really liked your description of the term sheet as the table of contents for the deal book.
Uh-huh.
I think that puts it in an easy to digest form. For that Queen City Angels template that you provided,
mm-hmm.
I assume that as you go further down the funding spectrum and you start looking at like Series A and stuff, that obviously all the details in those are going to change, but are there any big picture sections that are just inherently going to be different between an angel group and a VC? Or is that template big picture wise going to be pretty similar to what we'd see?
I think generally they'll be similar. But you know, when you think about the funding spectrum graph, you know, with all the bars on it,
yeah,
angels are creeping into venture space and venture capital firms are creeping backwards into angel space. The same is true with term sheets. So, and the best example I can give you is the term redemption. I've never seen redemption in an angel term sheet until mm-hmm. just this past year, and it was late in the year. So just very recently have I seen redemption as part of it. In venture deals, redemption I think is fairly common. So I'm not sure that the terms will really vary that much, except that, as you can tell, VC firms are good at giving angels haircuts. You know, we're real leery about that.
Sure.
I wish that there was something that we could put into an angel, an early stage term sheet that would prevent later stage investors from giving us haircuts, but that would be a poison pill. They're just, yeah. They wouldn't invest. They would look at what the deal terms were and they'd say, well, you know, we're going to have to pay these guys preferences and they get to still sit on the board and they get to do this and that. And so we're just not going to invest. So you can't really do that. So it's just the nature of the way the kind of investment industry has evolved. Venture-backed financing, venture funding is generally a tougher, more formulaic, stricter kind of approach. It's bigger money.
Mm-hmm.
People are responsible. The managers of those VC funds are responsible to other high net worth individuals. So there's a degree of professional kind of accountability there that's pretty tough. In a venture world, or I'm sorry, in an angel world, you're talking to the people who wrote the checks. So I'll give you an example of the way an angel works versus a venture capital fund might work. If a company goes belly up, like this environmental documentation, data capturing write-off that Queen City Angels had, and that I was a sidecar in, I worked on the board, I really struggled to try and get this company up and run, and we were not successful in doing it. When that company declared bankruptcy, we had a right to that code. It was in our deal terms that we were entitled to all of the assets of the company, including the computer code. So we actively considered taking the code, finding a CEO, and relaunching another company that was going to do exactly the same thing with that code. And that's not Queen City Angels style. That's not what we would do. We walked away. We left the two founders with their code. We released them of all their responsibilities to us. They were legally bankrupt, but we didn't pursue anything. A venture capital firm is likely not to do that. Venture capital firm, because it's later stage, because the company probably has some real meaningful assets, including tangible assets, they're likely not just to walk away. They're likely to dig in and make some people uncomfortable by claiming redemption rights. So not to suggest that VCs are terrible people. They're not. Again, that's just the way the industry has evolved. They're bigger and they're responsible to more people.
Thank you, John. I want to just, if I can jump, ask a quick question.
Marwan, sure.
Yes. Have you seen any case where the actual term sheet hurts the company instead actually of helping it? I mean, the whole idea of investing, of course, to kind of get the company to jump into the next level in terms of scaling up.
Marwan, I don't know of an example where that hurt. I think that especially today, startups have a tremendous support network. You know, like within UT, for example, there are four or five or six different sources of advisors, including legal. So I think the chances of a term sheet actually hurting a company are pretty low. And that's assuming that the founder is smart enough to really seek out, you know, some qualified outside advice. So I've never seen it. You know, the company that I keep bringing up, you know, this environmental data platform, I suppose you could say we heard him. When we started, he had a business with a client, and when we ended, he was bankrupt. So maybe we did hurt him. Maybe it was our fault, but I don't think so. I think that term sheets and founders together are designed to be successful, and hopefully the founder would seek enough advice to be able to ward off anything that might be harmful to him.
Thank you.
Great questions. Okay, well, Tabitha will send you our slide deck and the two workbooks. So you'll be able to, you will have a couple of new toys to play with. And we certainly are here to help you however we can. We'll keep talking. But in the event you come up with something that is still confusing to you, don't hesitate to ask. We're always here to help.
John, thank you so much for doing this lecture series. It's truly been great and helpful for everyone, I feel like.
Good deal.
Yeah, thank you, John.
You bet. So I think if we don't have anything else to talk about, we'll adjourn.